Okay.
Morning.
How are you?
All right.
You would be a good one.
That's always kind of.
She's lying.
Don't matter.
Wow.
At least no snow.
Okay. I say good morning to everyone. This rainy day, but that's okay. I didn't see any real rough bikers ride in this morning. Rain suits on.
Roger will.
Yeah, Roger will. The rest of us, we opted to take vehicles this morning.
Jim says pages.
But thank y'all for coming out this morning, and we want to welcome you. We've got more guests from Kentucky. Like the hillbillies are starting to come in here and take over. That's okay too.
We had another guy from Kentucky join this week.
I seen that, yeah, on the Facebook page. Nothing wrong with them Kentucky people.
We got to round up some Alabama people.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Some Wyoming people here.
There you go.
Well, let's open the service with a prayer, and then I'll turn it over to you. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come out to your house this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the many blessings that you pour out upon us daily. Sometimes we are in such a hurry in this world that we forget to just stop and look and listen and just think about the wonderful things that you've done for us. The places you give us to live, the world that you give us that we can look out and see the trees, and just the wonderful things that surround us, and it's all created by you. Lord, we ask that you be with us today, that you help us as we go through this service. And most important, if anyone is lost, that today would be the day of salvation for them. Heavenly Father, we just praise you for all these things this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I know I lost my Bible now. I think I'm David Wood.
You lost your Bible.
Roger's not here this morning. He's, I think, working the cafe because he's getting ready for his mission trip. So let's continue to keep him in prayer. He's going to try and meet us for lunch, though. So, and I don't know about Angela. I don't know about Gina.
Gina slept in a little bit.
Okay.
She'll be there for that. She
okay.
said she'll be there next week.
Okay. I know Bobby's working. Her boss is terrible, they tell me.
Amen.
Slave driver.
She was whining this morning about 9 o'clock going out to Brandon. I had already been at the hospital at 7 o'clock, so I didn't have a whole lot of compassion for her this morning. Not a lot going on that I know of. There's some rides happening. There's a ride February 10th. I don't know if there's anything next Saturday. Barb and I are going to be tied up next Saturday, so we're not going to be able to ride. My mom is moving up to Ormond Beach area from, we're going to move her into an ALF up at Ormond in the Pines. So we got to go down and pick our furniture up and all that kind of stuff. So we'll be doing all that kind of thing on Saturday. And we're not sure about Sunday yet. We'll just have to wait and see how bad you hurt.
Oh, I can tell you.
You can tell us how bad we'll hurt? David was whining about that as soon as he walked in. His boss is terrible to him. So, the ride yesterday with the BAT folks was pretty phenomenal. It was a good ride. We had a good time with them. We've talked with them a little bit about doing some partnering with them on some things. So we're going to set up a time and have them come up and do a presentation and talk with us, kind of give folks an overall picture of what we're doing. They have a really good ministry. They're all about getting people out of slavery. And I think that's a pretty phenomenal thing to do. We've been supporting them for several months now, and we'll continue to do that. But they said, we'd like to sit and talk with you all a bit more. So we'll do that probably the next week or so. Also, Heaven Saints Motorcycle Ministry contacted us this week. We've known a couple of them. If you get on the Facebook page, Gary Rucci, who's on our group page, is real involved with them. He got a hold of me and said, we're going to be in town during bike week. We want to put up a booth at Boot Hill. We've got commitment to do that. Can you help us? And I said, sure. So we started talking, and they're going to actually sleep here in the church that week that they're here for Bike Week. We'll have them put cots or mattresses or whatever those old guys can sleep on. I can't sleep on those anymore, but hey. So they'll be here that week, and they're going to actually come to the service on February the 13th, I think it is. And they'll talk a little bit about 10th. Is that what I put up there?
It's the same day as the ride.
I think it's actually the 17th, though. They changed it.
Oh, okay.
So it's the 17th. So they'll be here on the 17th, talk a little bit about their ministry, what they're expecting to do during Bike Week. And they wanted the place where they could send people after they meet them on the street. And so we're going to kind of partner and work with them on that as well. So keep them in prayer also over the next several weeks as they kind of get ready and prepare and figure out kind of what they're going to do. Good group of guys. They just had their international meeting up in Helen, Georgia. They're out of, I think, New Smyrna, Georgia is where they originated from. So pretty good group, though. Pretty good group of guys. Any other announcements that folks can think of? Barb's running the music this morning, so I would encourage you to...
Where are you him?
You didn't mess with my settings, did you?
I turned everything down. So, all right, stay with me and we'll start.
Yeah.
blood going.
Doxology, and everybody would stand and everybody would sing, and you'd end that song with praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and most of us had no idea what that meant. And so this morning we're going to continue our study on the statement of faith, and we're going to cover the concept of the Trinity this morning. And I got to tell you, this is probably the most difficult sermon I ever had to work on. Because people talk about it, people argue about it, people think about it, and no one understands it. And so we're going to dig into that this morning. But the reality of it is it's going to try us in terms of our understanding. Because there's concepts in it that are kind of outside of what we would want to think and what we want to believe. So this morning we're going to kind of jump into it. And I wanted to start with Matthew 1, or Matthew 28. And we're going to read, I think I have it as 19 and 20, right? But I'm going to start at verse 16 and read down through those. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee. Oh, by the way, I figured out why I couldn't read my Bible. I had my contacts in the wrong eye. But I can see it now.
That was scary.
What about driving?
Well, you know, that's a really good question. I guess I could see far away. You know, I have those bifocal contacts. And I think when I had them in the wrong eye, I couldn't see anything up close. So I'd be struggling to try to understand why everything was blurry. And I could see far away. So anyway, I can now see it. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age." Let's bow for a word of prayer. Lord, thank you for your love and for your mercy and for your grace, for allowing us to be here, for allowing us to study and understand your word and to become better disciples and better witnesses for you. Allow us to understand this issue this morning. Let us know what it is you want us to do. Let nothing in our own hearts interfere with that. In Jesus' name, amen. From the statement of faith, we believe that there is only one living and true God who eternally exists in three equal persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The God, we believe that God is the creator and the ultimate power within the universe. He exists eternally in three personalities, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. These three are equal and are one God. Jesus Christ. We believe that Jesus Christ has and continues to coexist with the God, the Father. He came to earth and lived a sinless and human life in order that we as humans can live eternally in heaven. Jesus presented himself as a perfect sacrifice for the sins of all people by dying on a cross. After 3 days, Christ arose from the dead in order to prove his power over sin and death. Upon completion of his great commission to teach others about salvation, he ascended to heaven, where he lives with God the Father, and returned to earth in his time to reign as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The Holy Spirit. We believe that the Holy Spirit, or Holy Ghost, is co-equal with the Father and Jesus. He was given to man so that we could be made aware of our need for salvation through Jesus Christ. He is given as a gift to all Christ followers at the moment of salvation, and he lives within each Christian to provide power for living, understanding of spiritual truth, and guidance to do what is right in God's eyes. Every believer is given a gift from the Holy Spirit upon salvation so that we may learn to live and serve the living God. This is a principle we argue about, we talk about. Some people deny it, some people believe in it. Some people put more power in one area. Some people believe that it's all about the Holy Spirit. Some people believe that the Holy Spirit is only evidenced by speaking in tongues. Some people believe that it's only evidenced by gifts, healings. The problem with that is that it diminishes the intent of the Trinity. The Trinity clearly, scripturally, shows us that there are three equal parts of a single God. Not that there is one part that is more important than another, but that all parts of that God are the same in terms of power and understanding in this world. This concept comes from a basic belief called systematic theology. One of the first books my father ever gave me after I was licensed in the ministry, and that was before I left the church for 28 years, by the way, was a book called Systematic Theology. Basically, what that concept is it's where you look at the scriptures and you pull out the concepts of the scriptures that aren't really defined solely in the scriptures. And you take into account all of those things to make sure that nothing goes out of alignment with other parts of the scripture. And so this morning, as we talk about this idea of the Trinity, I'm going to tell you, I am not a great Bible scholar. I am not one of those folks that has spent their whole life studying the scriptures. I can't speak Greek. I don't read Hebrew. But I know in my heart that there is a Trinity to God. I'm going to try and explain to you what that's about this morning, because I believe that the scriptures from the very beginning of time take us through the concept of the Trinity. The problem that most folks have is that they somehow believe that when that split between the Old Testament and the New Testament occurred, suddenly there was a Trinity. That's not the case. If you look at the scriptures as a whole, while it's not really defined in the Old Testament, it certainly begins to move toward a revelation. That there is a Trinity. That sounds like something my dog Riley would do. So this morning, I'm going to defend the tenets of the Trinity. I'm going to try and show you scripturally where it comes from. What I want you to understand is that there is nothing in the scripture that says Holy Trinity. It doesn't say, it's not like a manual that we get when we buy something and it says, this is your car. And you know it's a car. Because you wouldn't have guessed that by looking at it. There's nothing in the scripture that says this is the Trinity. But there's evidence and clear meaning of understanding the Trinity from beginning to end. St. Augustine wrote 15 volumes on the Holy Trinity. 15 volumes. There's a story that when he was walking along the beach one day, he came across a young boy who was digging a hole in the sand. And he would take a shell and run to the water, fill it with water, and come back and throw it into the hole he was digging. And St. Augustine said to him, why are you doing that? He said, I'm going to put the whole ocean in this hole that I've dug. And St. Augustine said, you can't do that. And the boy turned into an angel and said, St. Augustine, in your pea-brained mind, you will never fully understand the Trinity. It is a concept designed by God that reaches beyond your intellect. And so if you try to understand the Trinity through your intellect, it falls short. When I was in grad school, and most of you know, by training I'm a psychologist. I'm not a real psychologist anymore. But I do spend my time kind of working with folks. I began reading a book called The Psychoanalytic Theory of Neurosis by Otto Fenichel. And Otto Fenichel, in his book about the psychoanalytic theory of neurosis, did a reinterpretation of Freud's theory. And what he said was is that the problem that people have today trying to understand the Freudian theory is that they get locked up in the words that they know and not the words that were meant. And he gives an example. He says in the German language, there's actually three words for instinct. There is basic instinct, there's an instinct that changes based on need, and there is a third instinct. And so if you look at the theory based on what we understand that single word instinct to mean, we believe it's never going to change. And that was never the intent of Freudian theory. Well, if you look at the scriptures, you find the same thing. And the best example I can give you is that in the Greek, there are six words for the word love that we use today. In the ancient Greek, there is agape, philia, eros, storge, pragma, and philosia. And those six words define love in very different ways. The agape love is a love between that God has for man. It is not a love that we can do. It is a love that is given to us by God. And we'll talk about that. Philia is an affectionate love, and it relates to friends of equal status. It's where you and another friend have a relationship, and you love that person because of who they are. There's eros, which is that love that occurs between a man and a woman. And there is a love that goes, that transcends everything else. Storge is a love of tenderness, especially between parents and children. And there's a different love that occurs between a parent and a child. There's pragma. You're going to love this. Pragma is a model of love, usually when two people demonstrate that they've been together in a lengthy marriage. It's the base word for pragmatic. And then there's philosophy, which is love for oneself. And a love for who you are and how you were created by God. So if you think about it, concepts within the scriptures we try to understand in our own language, but the reality of it is that we will never be able to fully understand all concepts in the scripture, including agape love, because we can't give it. We can only receive it. It is God's love for us. Best example I can give you is, how many of you would give up your child for people that didn't follow you? That's the kind of love we're talking about that God has for man. My daughter, a week or so ago, Molly is a forensic chemist. She's running a forensics lab up in Kenosha, Wisconsin. And she was real excited. She was talking about they're getting a new piece of equipment. And she was trying to tell me all these things it would do. And I boiled it down to three simple concepts. You can put a sample in it. It will read the sample and give you a report. That's how I understood all that she was trying to tell me. And she was talking about atomic weights and all this. And I was like, yeah, great. So it's going to basically tell you what drugs were in the blood sample. She said, yes. I said, I got that. But beyond that, I don't get it. If we want to fully understand the concepts of God, we got to realize there's a limitation to our knowledge. There's a limitation in our intellect. We were created to be like God, not God. That's the difference. And one of the biggest struggles that we have today in our society is that people believe they are God. We've talked a lot about why is suicide such a high rate these days? Why do so many young people kill themselves? Because they believe that if they hit the reset button on their Xbox, they're going to come back to life. They don't understand that death is permanent. So let's kind of dig into this. The Old Testament certainly supports the doctrine of the Trinity. If you look at the very first verse in the scripture, it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." If you look at that word God in the original form of Greek and Hebrew, it uses the word Elohim. The word Elohim is a plural of God. And so it's basically it's saying, in the beginning, we all created you. It's not that word, God, in a monotheistic thought. Genesis 1:26 says, God says, let us make man in our own image. Let us make man in our own image. Verse 27 says, God created man in his own image. And the word God here is a plural. It's a big God, not a little God. You know, one of the biggest structural problems with understanding the Trinity is that Protestants are so rigid most of the time, it's hard to believe that they would have this concept of the Trinity, that there'd be three gods in one. And it's such a unique concept to faith that most faiths don't accept it. If you've ever been in a conversation with a Jehovah's Witness, they'll tell you, and they'll use this descriptor that 1 + 1 + 1 = 3. So what you're basically as a believer saying is that there are three gods. The problem with that is if you change that concept to 1 × 1 × 1, it's one. So we're not saying there are three gods out there. We're saying there is one God and three purposes. That's what we're after here. Isaiah 48:16 says this. Draw near to me. Hear this from the beginning. I have not spoken in secret. From the time it came to be, I have been there. And now the Lord God has sent me and his Spirit. The Old Testament predicts and says, there is a triune God. Three parts, fully equal. It's not three different people. It's not three different embodiments of a single God. It is truly this concept of three in one. In the New Testament, Matthew 28:19, we just read it. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus says there are three entities that you will bring to me. It names all three persons. It names all three bodies of who God is. There's no hint of inferiority. There's no God is over Jesus, is over the Holy Spirit. There's no direction of movement. There's three people that embody all of who God is. Matthew 3:16 and 17 says, as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, note, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. All three entities are present at the baptism of Christ. God who spoke from heaven, Jesus who was there, and the Holy Spirit descending on him. Again, there is no one person of the Godhood that is different or more powerful than anything else. 2 Corinthians 13:14, it says, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Again, there are three. in all these cases, there's a difference in terminology. There's a difference in direction. Sometimes it says Jesus, God, and Holy Spirit. Sometimes it says the Holy Spirit, God, and Jesus. So there's no indication that one is above the other. In the Gospel of John, in John 1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." John's interpretation of who Christ was is that he was the Word. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. So there's evidence from the very Old Testament to the very New Testament that there is a triune God. There is a Trinity. But the bigger question you have to ask yourself is, so what? What does it matter? It matters. And I want to explain to you why it matters. This is the only faith that defines three in a single God. There are faiths out there that have multiple gods. There are faiths out there that are completely monotheistic and saying there is only one God. This is a uniqueness to our faith that's different than anything else that exists out there. But there is, let me explain to you, there is nothing out there that explains Christianity the way it describes that Christ died for us. There is no other faith that does that. This is a uniqueness in our faith that's so different than anything else that it describes who God really is. It describes the character of God. It describes who he is and how his love for us is exhibited in his bringing forward Christ. It's important. It's important to our faith because it teaches us so many unique things about what we believe and why we believe it and why we are so different than any other faith out there. There is a worship that occurs. There's an example of so many things in those three bodies. You know, one of the things that people often say, which is certainly not biblical, and I'll say it to you, is they say God created man because he was lonely. Crap. God had relationships with two other people as a part of himself. He was not lonely. He created man for a different purpose. And he has tried to teach us that relationships are really about equality throughout our lives. You know, some people will say, it doesn't matter. It does matter. Because it is a uniqueness to our faith. It brings to us a different understanding of who and what the character of God is like. Paul says very clearly this, the sacrifice of Christ, the sacrifice of Christ can only be understood by the fact that Christ was fully God and fully human. If he was just human, the sacrifice of his death would have been atonement for his own sins because he would have been subject to sin. By the fact that he was fully God and not sinful, it explains the love that God has for us as beings. If we don't fully understand that, then what we give away is that God really didn't love us. And our whole faith is a sham. And I believe that if we really want to fully understand what salvation by grace means, it means God dying himself for us. He didn't sacrifice an animal. He sacrificed himself because he loved us that much. So, let me kind of dig into, now that I've gone through all that, let's start the sermon. Understanding the Trinity tells us what God is like. It tells us who he is and what he does. If God can create relationships the way he does in the Trinity, his expectation for us is that we can create those same relationships. The world wasn't created out of some flaw. If that's the case, we're left with St. Augustine's answer when somebody said to him, what was God doing before he made the universe? And St. Augustine's answer was, he was creating hell for people who ask such stupid questions. The world was not created because God was lonely. The world was created because he wanted to share with us the love and the relationships that he had with the Son and the Holy Spirit. If you look back in history, there's no mistake that man has tried to explain this 100 different ways. Freud said it was the ego, the superego, and the id. Watchman Nee said there is the man, if you read his book, The Spiritual Man, he says there is the soul, the body, and the Godhood. Man has always tried to explain it in threes. And the Trinity gives us a very clear picture that there can be relationships built on genuine love and respect for each other. God is a God of personal love and fellowship. He knows how to do that. And there are aspects of his being expressed in who we are in this world. We were created to replicate what God can do. It says, man was created in the image of God. The Trinity gives us that picture. Secondly, it tells us what the death of Christ really means. How else could we conceive of a person dying for the sins of the world? A mere man can't do that. We couldn't do that. We don't do that. Christ is fully God and fully man. If he were anything less, it wouldn't matter. We've talked a lot of times, and Barb and I have talked about this, that if you explain away all those things, then what was the purpose of Christ dying? It has no purpose. It is God finding a way to redeem man to himself. There is nothing that man could do that. David talked about the concept of salvation a few weeks ago. And salvation by grace means understanding that God made the decision to die himself to bring us to him. You know, there's all these movies on TV about half man and half God. There is no demigod that could have done this. The only way this could have been done for salvation by grace is that a person who was fully man and fully God and sinless created that way to get to the Father. Without the Trinity, his death has no meaning. And our salvation is simply an illusion. And I don't believe that. I believe that God created for us that mechanism to get to him. Like any good sermon, I have a third point. Y'all should have been here a few weeks ago when I had six. Thirdly, it tells us how we can approach God with a full understanding when things are revealed to us through the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not some apparition. It's not some thing that floats around the earth. I've heard people from different faiths and different churches talk about, well, God is just this being that floats around in the sky. And as long as you believe something, you're going to get to heaven. Now, I'm going to tell you, that's crap. God is a being with a part of him that is the Holy Spirit. John 7, 37 through 9 says, on the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and cried out, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture says, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. He said that above all things, there is a spirit that will inhabit your soul. This is not your conscience. God built us with a conscience. We know right from wrong from the very beginning of life. That's not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is that part of you that tells you how to get to God. How to build your faith. It's not given to all men. It's given to believers. And I'm going to be honest with you. There's a lot of thought and a lot of belief. And I've heard folks say that the only evidence of the Holy Spirit is to speak in tongues. I don't believe that. I believe that the evidence of the Holy Spirit is how you live your life and how you reach out to the people around you. That's the evidence of the Holy Spirit in your heart. It's learning to replicate that sacrifice that Christ had for us in our own lives for other people. I lied to you. There's one more point. Lastly, it tells us how the Christian needs to live our life. We learn that God is a personal God. God is a God of fellowship. God is a God of relationships. God is a God of being and love. 1 John 1:3 says this, we proclaim to you that we have seen and heard so that you may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Here, fellowship is built around three concepts. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We can't fully understand this three-in-one concept. Some people talk about different things. They'll say, well, the egg is like the Trinity. No, because the egg can be separated. You can take the yolk from the shell, from the omelet. God cannot be separated through his three beings. When you accept Christ into your life, you accept God, you accept the Holy Spirit. You don't get to choose. You don't get to say, I'm just going to take this part of it. You take it all. Think about it this way. There are infinite possibilities to replicate the relationship that God and Christ and the Holy Spirit have. And He has built that within us when we accept Christ as our Savior. He has built within us that concept of that fellowship and relationship. Salvation comes from the Father through the Son and is evidenced by the Holy Spirit. It is a three-part process. So this morning, what's our great conclusion? The Trinity is known only to us because God revealed it to us. It's not a concept we'd ever come up with on our own. It's not a thought process that any of us would think of. We can't put it together with duct tape and wire. We can't show evidence of it. But we can certainly know when we look at ourselves, is our relationship with God built on the Son and evidenced by the Holy Spirit? If you look at the evidence in the Scripture, you can only come to one conclusion. There is a triune God. There is one God who eternally exists in three equal parts. And He teaches us to live that way. If we slight any part of that, we slight God. We say we believe in God but not the Son, we slight God. If we say that we believe in the Holy Spirit is more powerful than anything else, we slight God. This was a concept that is divinely revealed in who we are. It's not humanly constructed. It doesn't come from evidence. I can tell you that when you fire up a motorcycle, that the gas goes into the carburetor or the ejectors, becomes a mist, and is fired by the spark plug. That's how an engine works. How man works is, we absorb who God is. We accept who Christ was. And through the Holy Spirit, we get a fire in our heart to serve. That's the Trinity. That's who we are as believers. As someone said one time, if you try to explain it, you'll lose your mind. If you try to deny it, you lose your soul. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Lord God, as we come before you this morning, we know that this is all about you. It's all about your heart and the love you have for us and the things you've done for us. And we know that there are things that you teach us that we can't fully comprehend, but we need to understand that it's built in your love for us. Thank you for everything. Thank you for the mysteries of who you are. Because it is in that mystery that we find salvation through you. Thank you for all of us being here this morning. For the love that you give us. And if anyone here, Lord, is struggling in their heart to understand you, let that come to conclusion this morning as they try to seek your will in their life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Stand with me.
myself in the light, and the darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice.
Lord, we thank you for this great day we have today, Lord. We thank you for the friendships we've developed here, with old friends and new friends, and bringing us together, Lord. And I pray as we go out into your kingdom, Lord, we show the love of Jesus, God, when we come in contact with us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Yes, you'll be here next week.
Friday. Friday.
Okay. I'll bring some stuff to look at. And I'll get an extra one of these.
My baby will be a year old.
He's enjoying it. Now I'm seeing some people.
I like to share.
It's the number.
Okay.